Well, welcome today to our service at Avonport Baptist Church. I am really excited. I don't know if you caught the service last Sunday, but I really felt an energy. I felt the Spirit of God, and I hope you guys were blessed by the service. We have started a series on a journey of faith and looking at our Bible heroes and what they can teach us about how we can incorporate that faith into our own lives. And man, it really excited me. So I hope that you enjoy this series as we travel through it. I'm going to be on vacation, so I've invited a good friend of mine, Wendy Stubbard, to share the next three messages, and she's going to be sharing with you. I just want to give you a little bit of update on who she is. Wendy is a graduate of Acadia Divinity College with a Bachelor of Theology. She also has a master's in family and marriage therapy from Briarcrest Seminary out west, and she is presently a trauma counselor here in the Annapolis Valley. We have shared a friendship together over a long time, and we've just completely reconnected since she's come back to the Valley, and I know that you're going to enjoy her. She's got a great message today and over the next couple of weeks, so sit back, enjoy, and God bless you guys. I'll be away on vacation, but look forward to seeing you again when I'm back. God bless.
Good morning. Our scripture reading today is from Judges 4, verses 1 to 10, and verse 14, from the Common English Version. After the death of Ehud, the Israelites again started disobeying the Lord. So the Lord let the Canaanite king Jabin of Hazor conquer Israel. Sisera, the commander of Jabin's army, lived in Harosheth Hagoyim. Jabin's army had 900 iron chariots, and for 20 years he made life miserable for the Israelites, until finally they begged the Lord for help. Deborah, the wife of Lapidoth, was a prophet and a leader of Israel in those days. She would sit under Deborah's palm tree between Ramah and Beth-El in the hill country of Ephraim, where Yisrael would come and ask her to settle their legal cases. One day, Barak, the son of Abinoam, was in Kedesh in Naphtali, and Deborah sent word for him to come and talk with her. When he arrived, she said, "I have a message for you from the Lord God of Israel. You are to gather together an army of 10,000 men from the Naphtali and Zebulun tribes and lead them to Mount Tabor. The Lord will trick Sisera into coming out to fight you at the Kishon Valley. Sisera will be leading King Jabin's army as usual, and they will have their chariots. But the Lord promised to help you defeat them." "I'm not going unless you go," Barak told her. "All right, I'll go," she replied. "But I'm warning you that the Lord is going to let a woman defeat Sisera, and no one will honor you for winning the battle." Deborah and Barak left for Kedesh, where Barak called the troops of Zebulun and Naphtali. 10,000 soldiers gathered there, and Barak led them out from Kedesh. Deborah went too. Verse 14, Deborah shouted, "Barak, it's time to attack Sisera, because today the Lord is going to help you defeat him. In fact, the Lord has already gone on ahead of you to fight for you." This is the word of the Lord.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of a shadow can rise, not a cloud in the skies, but his smile quickly drives it away. Not a doubt nor a fear, not a sigh nor a tear can abide while we trust and obey. Oh, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Share a few minutes with you today around the Word of God to explore its truths and promises for us today. I bring with me the greetings of Wolfville Baptist Church and the Reverend Dr. Scott Kindred Barnes. Shall we bow for a moment in prayer? Heavenly Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing and acceptable to you, O Lord, as we bow before your word, your cross, and your throne. In the mighty name of our risen Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Church, you Strengthen every strife. Give grace for every hurdle that we may run with faith to win the prize of a servant good and faithful. As stands of hope still light the way, retelling triumphs of His grace. We hear the calls and hunger for.
How do you solve a problem like Maria? The song is clear. Maria just doesn't fit in. She was a problem to be fixed, an annoyance to be solved. She was a wild and free spirit who loved God and really wanted to belong to the Abbey. Maria must have felt stifled and smothered in the cloister of the Abbey, and so she did the only thing she could think of doing to sustain any kind of mental, emotional, or spiritual health. She ran to the hills to join their anthem of praise to God as often as she could and for as long as she dared. Why was Maria such a problem? Because she simply didn't fit. She just wasn't like everybody else. Her innocent childlike faith and love for God convicted some and shamed others. And that, well, that is, what shall we call that? Maybe it is what could be considered the cardinal sin, an unforgivable error in judgment. Oh, that we would likewise be found guilty of such social and spiritual grievances for our innocent and childlike, obedient faith and practice. But we haven't gathered here this morning to study the Gospel according to Maria von Trapp. Though a study of her and her family's actual biographies is quite inspiring, no, we have gathered to study the Word of God, and as Brian said a few moments ago, he began a series last week on the heroes of our faith, searching for truths that will lead us in our life experience to live out our obedient faith. Brian noted in Hebrews 11, verses 1 to 2, that the author states, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen, for by it the elders obtained a good testimony." These two verses will be our anchor throughout this series. We will return to this truth to shape and sharpen our practice of obedient faith. Hebrews 11 is often called the Faith Hall of Fame. In it we read remarkable stories of lives lived by faith, holding on despite incredible challenges and despite never getting their complete reward. Faith for these heroes was not a trite cliche, but rather a hard-won and deeply held conviction based on the truth and reliability of God's character, experienced firsthand throughout their life journey. Through it all, they've learned to trust in Jesus. They've learned to trust in God. And so we can, and so we must. This week, we're going to briefly explore Deborah, pronounced Devorah in Hebrew, and out of deep respect for Deborah and her Hebrew heritage, I will refer to her as Devorah going forward. So Devorah is not mentioned specifically in the Faith Hall of Fame, but her partner in God's adventure is Barak. Devorah, like Maria, is someone who just doesn't fit in either. She doesn't fit our expectations of social and cultural rules for godly women of her day, or maybe even in our day for that matter. When we really explore the story of Deborah, we are confronted with the fact that Deborah just doesn't fit, and yet Deborah is honored and praised in Scripture for her obedient faith. Now here's an interesting fact. Just as the traditional Christian practices of faith use a lectionary on a three-year rotation to guide the public reading of Scripture and worship, so too does Jewish religious practice of faith follow a yearly schedule of public reading of Scripture in their worship. In synagogue, Deborah's story happens to be read early in February, if my calculations are accurate. It is a predecessor to the Festival of Trees in the Jewish calendar of scriptural readings. At this time, there's a huge effort by the people of Israel to plant trees for the health and well-being of the people and the land of Israel. Over a million Israelis planted trees in this festival in 2019. Planting trees is a form of remembrance and honor of Deborah and the great victory that Yahweh had won, the Hebrew name for God. And Yahweh won that victory in the battle between Israel and the Canaanite enemies because of the obedient faith of Deborah. Deborah is unique in all of Scripture. She is a prophetess, a judge, and a leader. No other judge was a prophet. No other judge was a respected leader to all of Israel. And no other judge was a woman. Deborah was all three. But to understand those uniquenesses, we have to first understand the tide and time in which she lived. The book of Judges is a time of in between the Exodus and the conquest of the Promised Land and the establishment of the monarchy. As Moses was leading the people of Israel through their journey to the Promised Land, he mentored a man by the name of Joshua. Joshua had stood at the door of the tent of meeting and heard the voice of Yahweh speak to Moses. Joshua had seen Moses' face glowing. Joshua tasted the manna and the quail and had drank of the water that flowed from the stone. Joshua developed his skills as a military leader under the capable hands of his mentor Moses. Joshua stood and grieved the death of his dear friend and mentor at the edge of the Promised Land. But before Moses had died, he passed the baton of leadership on to Joshua, who then successfully led Israel through to the conquest of the Promised Land. Shortly after the conquest and the dividing of the land among the tribes and family of Israel, Joshua himself had died. But Joshua died without having left a mentored, appointed, and anointed leader. Joshua dropped the baton, so to speak, and he left his people leaderless. The Israelites became a very loosely connected tribal regional people, not a cohesive nation, and they certainly did not have a standing national army. The Israelites were intended by Yahweh to be a people of theocracy, not a monarchy and not a democracy. However, the book of Judges records that without a leader, there was a secular downward spiral for the Israelites after the death of Joshua, where they would follow Yahweh, forget the laws and statutes of Yahweh, intermarry with the peoples of the land, fall into worshiping the pagan gods. Yahweh would send trouble against the land, usually in the form of leaders and oppressors. The people would endure it for a crime, for a time, and then cry out to Yahweh, repenting of their sin and begging for deliverance. And Yahweh would raise up a judge, usually a charismatic military leader, to do a campaign to free the people, and there would be peace in the land, usually only for as long as that particular leader would live. And then the spiral would begin, and it would churn downward once again. With each and every turning away from Yahweh, this cycle became ever more base and appalling, always reaching new lows. This created the context where we twice read the saddest commentary in all of the Old Testament found in Judges chapter 17, verse 6, and chapter 21, verse 25. The people did what was right in their own eyes. When we meet Deborah, it's about 300 years since Joshua had died. Now that's a long time to be in this grotesque downward spiral. But like the opening scenes of The Sound of Music, where we see Maria singing and twirling on the mountains in Austria, we find Deborah sitting under a palm tree, judging the people of Israel. We have very little introduction to who Deborah is. What we are told in Judges 4, verse 4 and 5, is that Deborah, the wife of Lapidoth, was a prophet and a leader of Israel during those days. She would sit under Deborah's palm tree between Ramah and Bethel in the hill country of Ephraim, where Israelites would come and ask her to settle their legal cases. So both Ramah and Bethel are in near proximity to Shiloh, the resting place of Tabernacle, the major center of worship. And it's interesting to note that Bethel means the house of God. I have been told that the land between Ramah and Bethel is rough, barren, and hilly ground. This is a place we find a woman sitting under a palm tree with people coming and going from all over the nation, seeking her wisdom, her insight, a word from Yahweh, seeking fair and righteous adjudication of their grievances. She is just an ordinary woman, and yet so very extraordinary. We are told that Deborah is the wife of Lapidoth, and we know nothing about Lapidoth, other than he's Deborah's husband. We are told that Deborah is a prophetess, but what does that mean? Yahweh spoke directly to Deborah. Yahweh downloaded wisdom, instruction, discernment, challenge, correction to Deborah, and Deborah in turn delivered the sacred information to the people. What a weighty responsibility. What a sacred trust. How did that happen? So we're not told of Deborah's background. We don't know what the family lineage is. We don't know whether she was the daughter of a priest, whether she was an orphan raised in the tabernacle, whether she was the wife of a wealthy and godly man who kept the Torah at the home and allowed Deborah to study it. We just don't know. What we know is that Yahweh spoke to Deborah on the merit of his will to choose her and use her in his kingdom work. And one other thing we know, Deborah was obedient. Deborah knew who Yahweh was. Deborah had a personal relationship with Yahweh, despite the history of gross apostasy in Israel and the development of a blended culture with the people of the land. In contrast to Israel, Deborah knew the Torah, and Deborah fastidiously stayed faithful to Yahweh and walked with integrity before Yahweh and before the people. Deborah was trusted by Yahweh, and she was trusted by the people. Oh, that could be said of us. The people of Israel sacrificed a lot to get to Deborah for a word from Yahweh and a fair and righteous adjudication of their grievance. The people had to pass local and regional authorities, most likely untrustworthy, unrighteous males, because they wanted to avoid the corruption and apostasy that had infiltrated Israelite society in that day. The people longed for truth, for righteousness and fairness, and they longed for holy judgments in their grievances. The people longed to engage with a person who knew Yahweh personally, as Moses had centuries before. Someone who could speak Yahweh's word into their lives. Do we long for that today? The people were thirsty and hungry for the truth of Yahweh. Deborah not only had a rich and solid faith, she had an obedient faith, embodying the theme of our verse. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen, for by it the elders obtained a good testimony. Whereas Deborah's fellow leaders throughout the land of Israel did not. They must have asked the same question as the nuns in the abbey, how you solve a problem like Deborah. However, the leaders of Israel respected Deborah enough that when she summoned Barak, an Israelite military leader, he answered. Deborah's region was in turmoil with King Jabin and Sisera, his commander, wreaking havoc on the Jewish people. This Canaanite enemy of Israel was very advanced with their warfare. The Canaanites had entered into the Iron Age. And it notes in verse 3 that Jabin had 900 chariots of iron. So I tried to comprehend the terror of this information that it invoked within the people of Israel. Can you imagine going to battle with your best, shiniest musket that your ancestors used in the American Revolution, and your enemy is approaching you with Germany's latest Leopard 2A7 battle tank? You might just feel just a titch terrified. Well, for the Israelites, who were not an army and hadn't been for approximately 300 years, standing before the Canaanite iron chariots, that's exactly what they felt. Absolute and utter terror. And that's what Jabin and Sisera were counting on, defeating the Israelites with their own terror. Yahweh, however, had a different plan. Yahweh had Deborah, and a prophetess and a righteous judge, a woman with a long history of trusted, obedient faith. You see, our little with God's much is more than anything the enemy sends against us if we choose to stand and walk in obedient faith. If the unrighteous leaders of Israel thought Deborah was a problem to be solved, Jabin and Sisera were going to find out she was not a solvable problem at all, because she was Yahweh's instrument of righteous judgment on an unrighteous enemy of Yahweh. Deborah summoned Barak, and scripture notes that interesting contrast. Barak, a military general. Deborah, a woman. Deborah informed Barak of Yahweh's mission with absolute faith in Yahweh. Barak, very pragmatic military male leader, just couldn't muster up enough faith to fully, confidently accept the mission. So Barak bargained with Deborah. I'll take on the suicide mission if you come too. Was Barak hoping that Deborah wouldn't go so he wouldn't have to? I mean, a musket facing a battle tank, really? Don't you feel your knees quaking and your tummy shaking and weak at just the thought of those odds? This was not the first skirmish Israel and the Canaanites had, and the results were always so predictable. The Canaanites won, the Israelites were devastated, lives were lost. I'm sure that Barak was not prepared, nor too happy when Deborah agreed to go with him to battle, nor would Barak have been happy with the prophesied consequence of his shaky faith. Deborah would go. Yahweh would win the battle for Israel, and a woman would defeat Sisera, and Barak would not receive the glory. So let's just add a little bit of insult to injury for Barak. And so it was. 900 iron chariots faced 10,000 Israelite ragamuffin renegades. The Canaanites were mad. They had to put down this rebellion. The Canaanites barreled down towards the Israelites, and the unthinkable happened. Every Canaanite was killed in battle. And Sisera was indeed killed by the woman, Jael, who incidentally was a descendant of the in-laws of Moses, and thus prophecy, leadership, and judgment of Deborah was proven once again, this time on a grand scale. So how did Deborah become a hero of the faith? There are a few things that we can take away from Deborah's life's practice that will stand us in good stead in our attempt to live out an obedient faith. Deborah knew Yahweh. She knew his unchanging character. She didn't know about Yahweh. She knew him. Deborah cultivated a deep, rich, personal relationship with Yahweh. We know that because when Deborah sat under the palm tree to judge, she judged by the truths and precepts of the Torah. She had to know the scripture, and she had to know the author of the scripture to judge with righteousness and fairness. Then as Deborah heard the word of Yahweh, she acted out in faith, whether in the judgment, the prophecy, or the leadership. And Deborah believed Yahweh would do what he said he would do, and so she stood in confident obedience. So this is a fascinating story, but so what? It's an ancient story of more than 3,000 years old. We're not Israel. We're not fighting the Canaanites to survive. Or are we? What enemies are we facing? And before you go there, let me be clear. I'm not intending to focus on the current flavor of political or social ills that we chew through as a society. So let me ask the question again. What are our Canaanites? What is stopping us from living out our obedient faith today? What is keeping us hidden as a Christian? What makes our knees shake and our tummies turn weak? Could it be that it's fear that cripples us? Might it be that we know that the Bible is true, but it just doesn't seem relevant for our day and age? Might it be that what cripples us are the words that were said to us in the past? We weren't good enough. That we didn't fit. That we don't belong. That we're not respected. That we're not educated enough. That we don't qualify to serve the Lord. Maybe what cripples us is that past action, that divorce, the abuse that was experienced, the affair, the abortion, that cardinal sin you are terrified to have discovered. What is it that keeps us moving from salvation faith to obedient faith? Some may feel that they're too old, or it's too late, or it's hopeless in this day and age. What is crippling you in fear of stepping out into obedient faith? I invite you today to take that thing that keeps you crippled in your faith and bring it to Jesus and ask Him to heal it so that you can step out into obedient faith. Whatever it is not too big for God to conquer. Because remember, our little with God's much is more than anything the enemy can send against us if we choose to stand and walk in obedient faith. So I encourage you, let's go back to the basics. And as Deborah did, learn afresh of who Yahweh is, what His character is, what He says within His word, and then to live that out as you encounter the enemy of your faith. Let's pray. Father, may You stir up the word that You have spoken to us, and may You move us to obedient faith, that the enemies of You are conquered within our hearts, within our homes, within our church and our community, that Your name is raised and praised for generations to come. In Jesus' name we pray.